Initially, we had invited Priya to join us, but unfortunately, we could not. She could not come, and then we also suggested that the entire team, a crew, can join us. We have Uma, the protagonist, and Nitasha, the cinematographer, and Amrit, the sound person. So we will have a we can have in-depth interaction with them. To start with. Can I ask Uma to, because she is the one who actually, as my understanding goes, she is the one who actually initiated the film by discussing with Priya. So can I request Uma to give a little brief about how she became a first painter and then diver, and then how did she persuaded Priya to make the film? Can Uma please share us the experiences? Yes, yes.
So, I closed the documentary on Kodal Isuri for you. So, since then, after seeing the documentary, I started painting corals as my theme. Yes, Nitasha also knows my story because my network is not that good.
Yes.
Yeah, I can help out actually. I can help her out because, can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you. Yes.
Yeah. So, Uma, I think, was living in the Maldives with her husband. And over there, I think she attended a lecture by this, I think, French woman who was living there on corals. And that really intrigued her. And that's when she started painting. She was already painting, I think. And then, but she didn't know that corals, actually, there were fish living in coral as well. And that's when she learned that. So that actually inspired her to learn swimming and then learn actually diving and to see, that's when she first saw coral herself and saw that how a coral is only alive when there are fish, you know, around it. And then I think Priya was working with NDTV at that time and Uma called her saying that I want you to make a documentary on... corals in the conditions of corals in India because Uma is from Tamil Nadu and she wanted to kind of like, you know, see what the situation of the corals are there from where she is. And at that time, I think Priya was like still working and was like, we don't really do documentaries when people like, you know, call us. But I think somehow, I think Priya felt some kind of a connection with Uma from then only. And they kind of stayed in touch and they became really close. And then when Priya did leave her job, this is, I think the first thing she went for was, you know, went back to Uma and then they thought about this and decided to make this film. So Priya and Uma spent a lot of time with each other. And I think that's how, like when I met Priya, I dive and I shoot. And that's how I met Priya through where we have a women's cinematographer group called IWCC, and the post was put on that looking for a cinematographer who dives. And so then I met Priya in Delhi and she told me the story, and that's how we met, like and then all the everything else is, you know. And I met Uma, and it's quite amazing because you know, you meet many divers and many people, but not somebody like Uma who at, you know, that age is always like thinking of also the environment and the impact everything has, everything she says and does, the impact, you know, of whatever she's doing is what is happening. So it really makes you think also. So I think, yeah, I don't know if I missed anything, Uma. Hopefully you got everything.
Yeah. Okay. Coming back to you, Nitasha, you gave a brief introduction. How you joined the film, but if you can give us a little inside view of the way it was shot, you know, the technicalities, the things that you looked into it while making the film, how did you plan shooting the film, if you can tell us.
Yeah, so there are two more cinematographers on board, underwater cinematographers. So I shot mostly the part which is in India, so all the bad water part, which is not beautiful at all, but it's real. And other cinematographers, Arnav and Titli, they live in Goa and they are divers as well and they shoot as well. So I can speak about my experience is that like when we first, I'd never dived in India anywhere before. I dive a lot in Thailand and I shoot not only underwater, but I shoot like above on land as well. But I remember while going to, we went to Tuticorin and we were like on the boat and we were like helped out there a lot by SDMRI, which is the organization that is, you know, helping with restoration in Tuticorin. And when I first entered the water, I mean, the conditions were really like bad in the sense I really couldn't see anything. And technically we are shooting, I shoot with like, you can use any camera, but you need a housing, underwater housing for it. So I was using the Sony RX100 and I had a housing for it. And it was very interesting shooting underwater because only Uma and I were going underwater, whereas Priya was on the boat. So for a director, I think it's a little like at first, and so was Amrit on the boat, Amrit who doesn't know how to swim. Priya also who does is now learned how to swim. So they both are on the boat and me and Uma in the water. And we really also, we can't talk to each other underwater. So also your perspective, everything changes underwater. What you think you can see and talk, like wave, that person is not seeing you because even your eye view is kind of fixed. So everything is like needs to be practiced on land first and discussed, and then you go underwater. And a lot of factors come in hand, like when there's a weather change, there's like a lot of dust, there's a lot of movement, there's a lot of silt, everything. So there's nothing in your control actually. So it was like quite an interesting experience shooting underwater in India, because you really see the kind of conditions that the coral. Actually, when I came up, I was sitting on the board very quietly, and both me and Uma were like, we were quite sad because, you know, I love the ocean. I love, like, diving for me is like meditation, you know, it's peaceful. It's like makes me one with nature in a very different way. It's immersifying in that way. And, but here diving, you could see the waste and you could see, and you can, when you're up also, you can see the industry around, you can see the smoke around, you know, it's always there. You can see the waste coming into the ocean. You can, and as soon as you go in, you know, when it's an unhealthy environment, immediately, you know, like, you know, that this is, you know, like I can't see anything and everything is, there are no fish. There is coral is all damaged. So it's very upsetting because then you don't like, it's upsetting to go down and see that and see how you are so much responsible for what is down there, which you really don't see that often. So our aim was like, we really did want to show the real reality of it than just like try to, you know, make it all look nice and pretty just visually. But it was just everything we shot was actually reality or whatever there was. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you, Nidasa. So I think people, I'm sure the audience, the participants will have questions to ask you, but I can just give another perspective from Amrit. If you can share your experience regarding sound of the film. How did you decide how you do, what happened in the sound department?
It's actually, working on this film, it's entirely a different scenario for me, but like I have worked on land, but it's entirely different acoustics when we work on water, space, caves, and all this, entirely different models. So initially I had spoke with Priya about underwater placing on some underwater microphones and all, but it is not at all possible. Yeah, it's not available in India. So the main thing it is, we cannot decide where to keep, and even Natasha has many issues with coordinating underwater, right? It's very hard. You hardly see people around. So they had an instance where to place Uma on a proper place, and it's hard to compose, right? So she somehow managed it. So bringing microphones into it, it is very hard to work inside. So we decided to work all these underwater acoustic things in the post-production levels. So making these soundscapes even more richer inside the post-production section itself. And regarding the other things which we recorded on live, it was pretty amazing to work on about the sea and all. It's something different, better than the land. There was some scenes where they come out from the water and they just speak about these coral things which they had seen inside. And with this SKMRI people, we shot some one scene after coming out from the water, right? So that was actually taken with only one boom. So of course we cannot level them. So for such instance, we stood up on this boat and I just armed the boom and got all these recordings very cleanly and lightly. Luckily, I didn't have enough wind at the time. So the environment has favored us a lot. Because if it is too windy, then it is very hard to boom for me. Because even inside the boat, it is pretty much hard. So sometimes someone will be holding me from behind. But otherwise, I cannot stand like this, no, on the boat. It is very wavy, so it's very hard to boom as well. Yeah. Shouldn't come inside the frame as well. No? So they had some conversation inside the boat as well. So for that, it was pretty hard for me to boom and all. But somehow we luckily had a proper coordination and we got it very right thing. So I had a designing perspective inside my mind while recording itself. So even though I need to, I did had a conversation with Nitesha about how the inside water across it would be, and because I never swim, I don't know to swim myself.
Yes. Now we can actually invite our guests, the participants, to give their comments if they have questions about the film. Mr. Sanmugadas, welcome, sir.
You have to unmute your microphone. That's all.
I watched the film. I was part of a short film festival, so I could join only a few minutes back.
Okay. Okay. Okay, Father Benny, you want to comment on the film?
First of all, I don't know whether Uma has finished with whatever sharing she wanted to do. But when I watched the film, I'm so impressed with the, you know, what achievement Uma has made. So my question to Uma is like, it's not a direct question, but just to share her experience more. You know, she talks about her first experience of diving, you know, with fear, anxiety, etc. So that was your first dive into, you know, to the ocean. And also I heard that you started painting in connection to your love for the coral reef. And towards the end of the film, I see that you are diving into social environmental activism. And I also see, I'm trying to connect it, that you have some more volunteers working with you to create this awareness among children, school children, among other people, etc. And also to work with you, that I was trying to assume that you and some other divers were trying to do some conservation activities. So how was your experience of diving into, not just dive into the water, but dive into painting, dive into social activism, etc.? Maybe you never thought that you would be doing this, but how do you feel now? That's my question to Uma. A few questions, technical questions, not technical, to questions or observation to Nidasha and also our sound designer. But can we hear from Uma some
yes.
more?
Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. The thing is, everything that's what after 40, life became so beautiful. I started reinventing myself, starting from painting. Hello, from painting and filming and diving, though there were many hurdles. But every time I took it as a challenge, and there were many people who encouraged me, including my family and friends. So the support I got from them made me take another step. I took baby steps because, but the first step in diving is called a giant stride. It's an oxymoron. It's called the giant stride, but I took baby steps, one step after the other, and there were always people to help me out, giving me a helping hand. And regarding the conservation thing, it is Priya's idea. I talk to people about this. It's Priya's idea to talk among the children in a school in Kodaikanal. So it was that is how it happened. In Kodaikanal, I was talking to school children. But I had shown a video, which I have been showing it to schools. But for the film, it was Priya's idea. And it's interesting. As you said, I never thought, but it's interesting from where I was and where I am now. It's slowly, it's paving a way for something new, something which is purposeful. I'm so happy about it. I won't call myself a...
Uma, the last shot, if I am not mistaken, you and Priya underwater, Nidasha, first of all, said Priya didn't know swimming, but she learned swimming. Is it Priya and you diving together and towards the end of the film? Is it that? Did I get it right? Was it you?
Me and Priya. Uma and Priya. But we will all be diving soon together, won't it? Won't we, Natasha?
Right.
Yes? That is a question for you, yeah. So that's how it happened, sir. Yeah, I think I answered your question.
Yeah, yeah,
you
did.
In spite of the... Yeah, thank you, sir. Thank you.
Okay, can I invite Mr. Balachandran?
Okay. Yeah, I have seen that film today. It was excellent documentary, very well shot, and my appreciation and congratulation to the madam who made that study and all these things, that artist, her name I am forget, Priya, I think. Hello?
Priya?
Uma is the protagonist.
Hello?
Yes.
Yeah, yes. Yes. It is very well shot. And my professionally, I am a marine geologist. I used to roam around for my work purpose on board ship. In that area, I learned scuba diving also. And I was very much afraid to go into water, you know. By seeing her brave attempt, now I feel ashamed of myself because I was worried because 35 years I roamed around, you know, the sea. But I was worried about the sea snakes. The corals will be in the shallow depth, I know, but there won't be much poisonous snakes. Even then, my attention is always around. And board ship we saw at Andaman area, then at upper here Tuticorin, that Rameshwaram, Kilakarai, very less quantity. Rameshwaram, we got good photos, but everything in a lying stage due to this effluent water and all these things. Then here, our Lakshadweep area also we could get some locality. So that also we reported. But about 10 years back, now government banned this thing. But the problem is, I went to... Can you hear me, sir?
Yes, we can hear you. Yes, good, good. Clearly we are.
Yeah. Kanyakumari, even now they are selling these corals. So I reported to the government. Then I interviewed them. They told, even now they are smuggling it from Rameshwaram belt and selling it here. So I read action and all these things. More than 60% quarrels were already spoiled. But this my appreciation for the photography and the acting and everything. Well, short film. My congratulations to all the participants. And especially Uma Madam also. She has a good diving expert. Okay, thank you all for the better film.
Thank you. Amrit, you can continue. Just you wanted to say something.
It's like that. It was the way which I had planned to work on Coral. First, initially when Priya called me, I had no clue about corals at all. So later I just looked at it and I find it out this is all the issue and all. So later when I got into the project, I came to know much more about corals and all. So regarding the sound part, it was majorly on the land area. It was normally like a normal documentary kind of stuff, which the way which we showed films, right? It was not normal at that, in that way. Only it was a little bit difficult over the show and all. When I was in the port, it was quite difficult over to record it. But it is fine to work on. It is pretty amazing to work inside, not without the land and all. It's got good to work on that.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you. Yes, thank you, Amrit.
I have a question to Amrit, and also that I have a suggestion.
Sure.
We have one person called Rex Joseph. He has a team. They are into kayaking. Through kayaking, they are doing environmental protection, removing waste and extra. Maybe after this weekend. I just have one simple question to Amrit. You said underwater microphones are not available in India or something like that. I heard you saying. But in feature film productions, I have heard, for example, one Malayalam film, Anarkali, it was shot in Andaman or wherever. The recordist gave me the impression that they used underwater microphones, etc. So I was surprised that
it is normally like that. They used to say such things, but they can actually get the underwater microphone from outside. Even in Dubai, I had been used underwater microphone, but I never seen it available in India. Maybe it might have a normal, the very old one, which is like a capsule having a long cable outside, which we can directly connect into the recorder. It has only just one bass, a little bit of kind of tone. They might have been used that. There are several variety of things which we don't get it in India. So normally the production people will say all this.
That's it.
Over here. Yeah.
Okay. Father Benny, you wanted to introduce Rex. Just if you can give a brief introduction, we can invite them.
I'm right. Yeah. I have been noticing that Father Rex has a team of, they do kayaking. And they have associations also, young people doing kayaking. And it's not just for pleasure, kind of, that's all part of it. But they do remove plastic from backwater, rivers, and etc. When we posted the link of this film, their group got excited. We got some reports also. Some of the audio recordings we sent to Uma, which was in Malayalam and English, and she was also excited. So if Amudan want to invite Rex to say something about this
movie,
how he was impressed about the film.
Yeah. Okay. Hello, myself Father Rex, a good friend of Father Benny. I was doing my recording engineering course, a reputed course in Chetana Sound Studios, which is closely associated with or which is run by the CMI congregation. And Father Benny, he was a good inspiration for me for past 2 years while I was doing my recording engineering there in Chetana Sound Studios. And we got chance to talk. And I could interact with him many of my lifetime there. And I could speak at times about my kayaking and our team, which is formed to protect the nature, especially the water bodies in Kerala and other rivers in India. And we are also associated with all the people who are nature lovers, especially in the field of water bodies. All around the world, and we have got two major kayaking events in Kerala. The first one is called Musiri's Paddle, and which takes place in the first weekend of every year. We paddle for 40 kilometers from a place called Musiri's in Kerala. From Musiri's to Marine Drive, we have got 39 kilometers, and we paddle 120 paddlers together. And as we paddle these 40 kilometers, we enjoy nature. Then we have conversation with fishermen and people who live at the coastal area. The same time, we used to collect waste materials floating in the water bodies, especially plastic covers, kits, plastic kits, chappals, CFL lamp, then incandescent lamp, then mosquito killer bottles, liquid bottles, then many materials that human beings use every day is accumulated very badly in our water bodies. And what happens, slowly it gets accumulated at the bottom of the water bodies, then the plants and corals, such things which are essential for the ecosystem, is spoiled very badly. And what happens, the number of fish is going down. The quantity of oxygen found in water bodies is going down. And phytoplankton. I'm asking a question. How many of you heard about phytoplankton? Phytoplankton. We have got a plankton, a microorganism, in both animal world and vegetable world or plant world. We have got the plant world and animal world plankton. Plankton can be divided into two: phytoplankton and zooplankton. And this is zooplankton. They are the people who create above 50% of the oxygen for the entire world to breathe. These zooplankton create oxygen. They provide oxygen. It's not the plants we find on the land alone create oxygen, but the phytoplankton found at the peripheral level of the sea body and any water body create oxygen for all the living organism on earth. So when we destroy, when we pollute water bodies, especially the sea area, what happens? We destroy phytoplankton. To our wonder, that is the major food category for blue whales. If you go for the food of a blue whale, you find it is phytoplankton, which is not seen by human eyes. We cannot see phytoplankton. They are very little, very small for us to see. And they are blue whales intake these phytoplankton as their food. And if we destroy these water bodies, what happen? The entire ecosystem collapse. So we have a team internationally, nationally, and locally. We have team giving input sessions for the youngsters, especially children and college youngsters. As we paddle 40 kilometers, we at times get into the nearby schools at the coastal area, and we give talks. And these children come to awareness, and they start their lifestyle in such a way to protect the nature. And we have got the 40 kilometers paddling in the month of January and first weekend. And we have got another paddling called Chaliar River Paddling. That is all about 69 kilometers, starting from Nilambur to Baipur. So it starts from Nilambur and we paddle together to Baipur. And this 69 kilometers we clean. After our paddling, you will find not even a single piece of plastic in Chaliar River. And what is the impact? It has been, we have been doing green paddling or Chaliar River paddling for past 5 years. What is the result? Now the people who live at the coastal area have stopped throwing plastic to the river bodies. Why? Because they see hundreds of people paddle together and collect the plastic material that they have thrown. They feel shy. And the local government bodies there is got conscientized and they started giving awareness programs and people have stopped throwing plastic waste to the river bodies. And what is the result? Now from Chaliar River, plastic moving to sea waters is very, very less.
Yeah. Oh, very nice, sir. Very nice to hear that, Father Rex. Coming back to the film, can I request you to give a comment on this film, your feedback on the film?
Sure, if you have questions. I can definitely comment on the film. Actually, I was a bit curious about the title of the film, Coral Woman. Coral Woman. So I was too much taken up by the title itself. A very nice title, and that will really lead to the content of the movie. And as I started watching the movie, I was all involved in the movie. Why? Because my mind setup and my attitudes all go with the movie. I towards the end said like this, I can share this link to maximum number of people. Why? Because this is what I want to talk to the world.
How can I too start this coral planting in our seashores? So to whom shall I consult, or what is the step that I should take to make a coral garden in certain areas?
There's this organization called SDMRI, which is in Tuticorin. So if you look them up, they do a lot of restoration work in Tuticorin itself, of coral, replanting and seagrass restoration. And they have a lot of students there working, and, it's not such a, it's run by the government. So they're trying their best in that sense. But that's one space where that is like you can look it up and you can see what's going on with that.
Did you come first to diving or to cinematography, or which take you from what to what?
No, actually, I studied cinematography for, I'm from FTII, the Film Institute. And so I've been working as a cinematographer first, and then diving just happened randomly. I wanted to get into diving, and then you're diving, and if you're a cinematographer, you want to shoot everywhere you are, right? So it just automatically came with first shooting, and then started diving later. So much later than cinematography, but they now go hand in hand, I feel, because it's the better a diver, the better cinematographer you become. It goes differently when you're underwater. Because your body is more like, you have to be a good diver to shoot, because you can't, there are a lot of things involved while diving. You're equalizing with your hand, you have to learn how to equalize without using your hands while going deeper, so with your jaw, while wearing a regulator, and you are holding your hands like that because you're holding the camera, so your hands are always not available where it would usually be available if you're just only diving. So the better diver you become, the better cinematographer you become underwater. And so I think Uma knows that. Uma has been diving now for a while. And Uma knows how the more you dive, the more comfortable you get underwater. So whenever people say, oh, I went diving, I'm so still scared and everything, and I just keep telling them, just keep diving. Because the more you dive, it just becomes automatic. Everything underwater becomes automatic then.
Other than diving and swimming, could you learn something new while creating this video?
Learn new, yeah, yeah, of course. I mean, you know, like you talked about Uma and how there are no words to express what you feel and what, you know, what you want to say to her. And that's the same feeling I felt. Now I've known Uma for now a few years. And when I first met Uma, that's the whole thing. Like, you know, I mean, we get so busy in dive shooting and doing what we do. And we are aware of the environment and we try to do as much as we can and learn from each other. But it's great to learn from Uma of how, you know, how involved she is. And I think I learned a lot from her and from Priya as well. And as a team also, I feel working with this kind of a team where it was Amrit, myself, Uma and Priya. It's a very small team. And just coming back every day and discussing what we felt and how we saw and just talking to each other. I think talking to each other changes a lot of things, of the questions you have and what you want to do about it, not only about our work, but about the world, the environment, the politics and everything around. And each one thinks so differently and learn from each other and also argue with each other. That kind of openness, if it's there, if there's a conversation, then we can have a conversation and convince each other or understand each other better. So I think I learned that a lot from each one of them, you know, especially like with this shoot, because we've been on a lot of shoots and this shoot really, I mean, it feels like a family. You know, we are on a group right now. There are other people also involved in this film. And we are always sharing with each other what we are seeing, what we are thinking. You know, we've shown the film in Mami and it was mainly with the children. And we had some, you know, 200 kids each screening, two screenings, watch the film. And seeing children react to it in a way where getting up and saying, you know, what can I do? Shall I stop using plastic? Okay, I'll, you know, go home and then draw also what they thought. You see the kind of impact it has, just something little which you didn't feel it could. And that changes the things that you do in the future in your life. Being like, you know, you think, oh, shall I not, what's my point of cleaning this? It's not going to clean the entire world. But you don't understand that little cleaning will impact somebody else, maybe 10 years down the line. So I feel like that has really, this film that way has really impacted me personally in that sense, you know. So yeah, that's a lot that I learned from this, except of like swimming, diving, shooting, everything.
Thank you. What's the sound that is like under the water? What it feels the how is the real audio under the water that you felt if you have gone down?
I had been snorkeling. I cannot swim.
No, but you must have heard the footage had some sound. So you can maybe talk about that. You know, the footage had some sound which you can hear through the camera, no, a little bit. I think maybe...
Yeah, it's kind of that. A crispy kind of thing. But it's, we haven't used any proper microphone for underwater things. No. But it is actually a crispy thing which caught... which normally hit on this body of this camera, but it is not the actual thing which we get. Of course, you know it pretty much well, better than me. You used to hear it a lot now. So it is almost like a bassy kind of thing, which is more kind of a rumbling over the ears across when we have the movement in a proper way. There will be a smooth, soothing sound of a very bassy tone. That is the normal static bed of this acoustics underwater. And even there will be some kind of other session of bass rumbling far away a little bit if there is some movement in a far place. If the water is static, you won't be hearing much any kind of things. You can only hear your breath properly. When you close your ear like this, no, you can hear only your breath, right? So such kind of thing will be there. And if there is a lot of movement, if it is an active aliascape of underwater, then you can hear a lot of wild variety of bass kind of sounds. That is what we hear inside it. That is what
I can add a little bit to that, like when as a person going underwater, you are hearing a lot of your own breathing. That's why I always say diving is like meditation, because everything is controlled with your breathing. Your movement, everything underwater is controlled through your breathing. So when you breathe out, and there's a delay. When you breathe out, there are bubbles that come out. And when you breathe in also, there are bubbles that come out. So when you breathe out, it takes 2 seconds and your body slowly moves out, downwards. So if I want to move in the underwater, I just breathe out very fast and I'll go down faster. If I want to come up, I breathe up really fast, and that's how you move the camera also underwater. So you got to think that, okay, I want to go down in the shot. So I start breathing out only to go down. And if I want to go up, then I start breathing in. And then if I want to stay there, I'm just slowly breathing in and out, in and out. So a lot is to do with your breathing and you're hearing it. That's all you hear. And it's a very soothing sound, you know, because to be able to hear your breathing in water with that bubble is very soothing. So you can really, it's like mesmerizing, and it's the world that makes you just feel like, okay, I'm so little. And I always say, like, you really come into one in that way, like, you realize that as humans, we are so equal. All we need is oxygen to breathe. Other than that, underwater doesn't matter. Man, woman, religion, caste, from where you, how tall, short, nothing. All you need is to be able to breathe. And that's the only thing that matters. You know, you can't, the next rest doesn't matter. And the language also. Language is only, all you need to do is, am I okay? That's it. This is the most important sign. Underwater. Am I okay? And this, you need to have somebody has to reply back. So this has to stay up till you don't get a reply back from the other person. I'm okay. This doesn't go down. So it's only about knowing, are you okay? So it's such the feeling only starts. So when you go down and you see dirt, it takes away from that a lot. Because it's that environment is giving you so much and you're just going in there and like ruining it, you know? So so the sound for a diver is very different. But you got
continue.
No, you got it really well though. Like you got that feeling really well. Because he used to keep asking me, how is it? And I used to describe it in a very, like, you know, romantic way, and, you know, be like, this is what I feel. And he's like, no, how does it sound? I'm like, okay, this is that is that. And when I saw it, I was like, wow, okay. Like, I feel like I am underwater.
Basically, we have to flip it around. Like, in the airborne acoustics, which we hear in the land, just imagine direct opposite of it. Just flip the sound. Yeah, we will be hearing a lot of categories of some highs, mids, and everything. Just forget about the highs, forget about the mids, just hear the bass. Mostly that will be inside this underwater acoustics. Just opposite of this air. What we are hearing on the land, no? It will be directly opposite to that.
Quite simple. And then the next is to the cinematic. So one is the technical question, which was the camera that you have used there, like underwater, and what was the precautions that you have done, like, to make this camera safe? Have you met with any accidental situations underwater while doing the camera?
I got the first question is, the camera that we use is the Sony RX100, and the camera has a housing. So there's like a underwater housing that the camera goes into. And it's secured very well with sensors. So if there is water going in, I get a beep. So I know if there's water going into my camera housing to protect the camera. Sometimes you can't do anything because you really can't come up really fast. You need to take that precautions to come up because your body pressures have to change as you're coming up also. We didn't shoot that deep here, so that didn't matter that much. But
really, it is an underwater camera or like a ordinary camera with an waterproof casing?
There's a special housing casing that comes for the camera. So each camera has their own casing. You can't put any camera in any of the casings. So this casing is specially for this camera. You can't put another, like the 5D. will have their own housing. So there are different housing compared to different, like they go up to crazy amount of prices. You have your, when you shoot feature, then you have you have the big housings that carry the red and all the bigger cameras, which are also more specific. They have many sensors all around everything. So a lot of things are taken care of. So
like,
then it's a big...
Okay, so when like you were doing this thing, was it all safe or like have you met with any accidental situation like underwater?
No, not that. Like I've been diving since many years now. I've like done around, I don't know, more than 1,000 dives. You are always aware of every situation that's happening. But like we were pretty that way. We had really good help from SDMRI actually. So it was their boat and I had my own equipment. So, you know, you're very sure about that. And then Uma's also been diving. So Uma was going. So you're taking a lot of safety regulations because you have to understand there is a lot of safety involved while diving as well. So you need to take that into consideration first. And then the work part of the shooting part of it happens. So that was always like, there are a lot of things involved. First, all that is taken care of. And then, so we were lucky. I mean, we had, the weather was a little, like it started raining one day. So we had those issues. But other than that, like there was no, we were lucky. Like there can be issues, but we were lucky that we didn't have any of those issues.
So there is one more doubt. So how was the process of directing underwater? Like how did Priya said role?
So... It was very, I mean, this is the first time also now Priya and I have worked together for a while, but that was the first time we were actually working together as well. So it's always like, you know, it's, you're both apprehensive, right? Like, will she be fine with what I shoot? But underwater, it's crazy. Like we had many, like I said, like we were there and we were together, just the four of us. We had discussions on what we were thinking and what she wanted. And Priya that way is amazing to work with. I'm not just saying that because she's not here, but she is very easy in the sense she's very open to what your suggestion is. She really believes that it's a teamwork and she wants to know what everybody's idea is. And that automatically makes you feel very comfortable on a shoot. So she will, we used to discuss and we spent time together earlier talking a lot about what we are looking for and what we want and what we want Uma to be, how she should be underwater and everything. The first day when we went underwater, we went down and it was, like I said, it was the first time me seeing that kind of a condition. So I was like taken aback and I couldn't find Uma. So it was a little crazy. And we come up and Priya's on the boat and she would be like, you know, what happened? And I was like, I have no idea. Like, I don't know what we've got. So then we got on the boat and she would look at stuff and then we would discuss, okay. For the beginning sequence, which is shot, actually you're asking me, sir, where it's shot in Sri Lanka and our two other cinematographers have shot it. And that they really practiced a lot on land actually, where they would stand being like, this is a coral, this is you, Uma, you will be walking like that. And then the camera will be here. So a lot of these kind of things for those sequences were done on land first. Because even if Priya could dive, it's very difficult to direct underwater unless we have the really expensive equipment of the mics, you know, with sound thing where we can hear each other and talk to each other. So it all depends on that. So, I mean, yeah, it was interesting. I'll just say that. But I think Priya was very clear on what she was looking for. And that makes it easier for the rest of the crew, right? If your director knows what they want and is also there to listen to what you have to say and actually take it into consideration. So it just, I think that's why like the team works well, you know? So yeah, I think, I hope I answered that.
Natasha. Okay. Yeah. Yes, Father Benny. Go ahead.
I have one small question and also a comment. Question is, Natasha, how long the whole process of starting from discussions, preparations, shooting here, shooting in Sri Lanka, and then post-production, etc. And so the whole process, I know it has taken some time. So if you could give us a brief idea about how long. And my comment is very, I want to congratulate the whole team for the, you know, the way you have produced the film and presented the film is, it's political, but it's nowhere it is loud, you know, in making any statement and etc. It is coming out so spontaneously, so smoothly. And also I wanted to hats off to Priya because it's kind of, you know, director's film, but we don't see the director coming in, even though, you know, it's not nothing to do with the shooting process, but the way she has structured. It's mostly the way Uma explores things and she does a research kind of thing with and then she gets into the activism and all. The whole thing has come out really well, good structure. And the political issue concerns that you wanted to raise also have come out really well. That is why this film is going to stay with the people, the spectators. It is going to stay because it doesn't do any sloganeering or anything, but it has everything. So my question, so please convey this response to, you know, your whole team member. My question about the procedure or the process, whole process, if you could share a little bit.
Like the process in the sense we would start, you mean by like how we started shooting and then how the...
How long did it take?
Oh, how long? Actually, you know, surprisingly, I mean, the real proper shoot which we shot was not more than how many? 7 days, Amrit? 7-8 days?
Yeah, it's 7 days in Tuticorin. And few,
one
few
day
days in Sri Lanka.
Yeah, and Rameshwaran, right?
Rameshwaran.
But also Priya spent a lot of... Priya also was shooting. So Priya's also shot quite a bit with Uma. So Priya spent a lot of time with Uma and they were shooting while Priya was editing as well. So with that process, I think Priya will be best to be able to answer that. But I can... Amrit and we can speak about the shoot, because the shoot was more hands-on over there where we all met. I also met Amrit for the first time over there and Uma all together in Tuticorin. And that's when we started, where the first day we were just sitting and discussing of and getting to know each other a little better. And like you said, sir, like, you know, you said something very interesting, how everything is there in the film and how it's not only a political film or only an environmental film or only about somebody's journey. Everything is there in there. And I feel that is each one of us in a way, because, you know, each one has their political view, but each one's political view maybe not is different from each other. There must be like certain value must be the same, but the view is not, some may have a very strong view, some may have a not that strong opinion. So I like that. I really like that the film had everyone's input in it, of how they feel, and everybody's, you know, everybody's little bit is there. And that's all Priya made sure it was not only her view, that it was Uma's, it was Amrit's, it was mine, it was Arna's, it was everybody's view was there. And I think that makes a huge difference in what the product is. So I think that process is like, you know, that process of involving everybody who has been part of it and to give that out there, because your viewer is also not that one person, the viewer is many people. So she, I think, always had that in mind, and that's like, I think that works well. So that process is totally to her. Where we till date, like I was saying, we, you know, she was always there. Every discussion, every decision didn't need our opinion. As a director, don't need, you know, the other crew members' opinion once, like especially cinematographers, once they are done, they are like out, you know. And so that makes a difference, like, you know, of... But she always involved each one of us because she felt that that was important, because how it was affecting each one. So I think that does come out in the film, definitely. That process. Oh, yeah. Okay. I mean, Amrit could add to it. I don't know if there's something you want to add.
One thing which you had said, no, that is, you used to speak a lot. I mean, this chat.
Yeah.
Charge chat, the lunch chat, the dinner chat, everything adds to the film.
Chai pe film making, no? Chai pe charcha, chai pe film making.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah, that actually added a lot. And the scheduling chart, which Priya has made, no, that is a brilliant plan. Yeah. the time management of her notes. As I never seen such a time management in a proper way ever in a production. Yeah. That made I even more better to work for all of us. Yeah. That's why we took 7 days to film whatever we were working on.
Yeah.
In Tuticorin and plus the other days.
Yeah.
Can you hear me?
Sina, please. Yeah, welcome.
Finally. I just want to add that I love one line in the movie, like, Naan kaanum ulagangal nee kaana venum. That is like a poem kind of thing for me. The whole, this soul of the film was in that line. And that took me, I just love the sentence, and I think the whole idea of the film is capsuled in this sentence. And I really I had in mind, like, we have in Kerala that mangrove planting in northern part of Kerala, like the way they are doing coral planting, no, the same thing happening. So I think both of them, but coral planting is a little bit more complex, I think, compared to the mangrove planting. This is also it's like underwater kind of thing, no. So all these things came into my mind when I watched the film, and everything, it's like, there is environment issue, even the gender issue and the class issue, all these things have been incorporated in this film. I thoroughly enjoyed even the lady's reaction to Uma's diving into the sea, and she was wondering how a woman do all these things, and that was a very genuine expression that we are getting. That's also very interesting. That's why I said all kind of thing, gender, environment, animal, and everything was there. So it was totally inspiring experience for me. I just want to add this, like, I also want to see this coral thing if I get an opportunity, like, naan kaanum ulagangal nee kaana venum. I just love that.
Thank you
for this wonderful film.
Tina, join Natasha and go for scuba diving.
Surely, I would love to do that.
So I would like to ask one more question. So how can an ordinary person, like, go for this diving? How is the process? I would like to know.
First, learn swimming. Swimming is the first thing. Okay. And
next step.
So there are a lot of places, like there is in what do you call, in Andamans, you can go in I think there is, now they've started in Goa also, and so there are places you can go, but first start with swimming and snorkeling, and then you can slowly, like, you know, be more comfortable, and you can go to these places and learn.
So finally we started the online streaming and online discussion, so hopefully we can continue to do that. Thank you, Natasha, and Amrit. Thank you, Uma, and Priya. And of course, we can all thank together. Sina, finally, we can see Sina. Finally,
ready to dive.
The shot for the last frame. Just kept the last moment, last scene. Okay. So thank you all. So
thank
if you want to, Father Benny, you want to finally say thank you, everybody, and just, it's up to you. Can wind up.
Anyway, special thanks to, on behalf of Vidyor, special thanks to your team, to Priya. And Priya's, we have screened her films at our earlier editions, and when we used to conduct it at a larger scale, not online film festival, but her My Sacred Glass Bowl and etc. We are screened. So please give our regards to your team, and thank you very much. This was our first venture of online screening. So we want to continue. And Amudan also was our inspiration to take the first step. Everybody's talking about Uma was talking about of taking the first step. So we have taken the first step. Yeah. And so we'll be able to go ahead. And thank you. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you all.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you all. Bye.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.
So this is like that, right?
Yeah. Okay. Wait, let me take a picture for Priya actually. Uh-huh. Everybody do this, then we'll take.
Yay.
Yeah, got it. Thank you.
you missed me.
Oh, we'll take one. We'll take one.
Okay.
I don't know, it's not coming now. Yeah, got it. Thank you. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.